Hi, I'm Petty Officer Kara Hunt. Join Staff Sergeant Jimmy Williams and me on Navy Marine Corps News. This week, the Defense Department announces who will build the military's next generation strike fighter. Find out what sailors and Marines are doing off the coast of Southern California, and get the results of the 26th annual Marine Corps Marathon. These stories and more on Navy Marine Corps News.
Navy Marine Corps News. The Defense Department announces who will build the military's next generation strike fighter. Find out what sailors and Marines are doing off the coast of Southern California, and get the results of the 26th annual Marine Corps Marathon. These stories and more next on Navy Marine Corps News. Welcome to Navy Marine Corps News. I'm Staff Sergeant Jimmy Williams.
And I'm Petty Officer Kara Hunt.
Defense officials say several weeks' worth of airstrikes in Afghanistan have reduced the threat from opposing ground forces. Defense officials say they're moving at their own pace in the war against terrorism.
We do not intend to stop until we've rooted out terrorist networks and put them out of business, not just in the case of the Taliban and the Al-Qaeda in Afghanistan, but other networks as well.
Defense Secretary Donald Rumsfeld says the campaign will continue until Americans can go about their lives without fear.
Americans, as you know, do not seek war. We did not seek this war. It was thrust upon us. It is a matter of self-defense, and the only way to defend against terrorist acts is to take the battle to the terrorists. It was thrust upon us, and we love liberty, and we need to do whatever it will take to defend it.
Military leaders reiterated that this fight is a marathon and not a sprint.
The Taliban and Al-Qaeda are unlikely to take a holiday. Given the fact that they have killed thousands of Americans and people from 50 or 60 other countries, and given the fact that they have sworn to continue such attacks, we have an obligation to defend the American people, and we intend to work diligently to do that.
Service members understand the need for a sustained and thorough fight against terrorism and are committed to it. Military leaders have expressed their appreciation to the American public for its support.
The people of this nation have united in a wonderful way against an enemy who opposes our way of life. It's, of course, encouraging and rewarding for a person like me who wears the uniform to see this kind of response.
Navy Secretary Gordon England recently visited sailors and Marines in San Diego. Petty Officer Dwayne Smith of our San Diego Bureau files this report.
Sailors aboard the USS Bella Wood and USS John Young greeted Secretary Gordon England with rousing cheers.
It's an honor for all the ships out here that he chose our ship, and for a time like this that he took the time out to come out to speak to a crew, especially when we're getting ready for deployment.
It shows that not only him, the president, but the whole country, rest of the government and everybody else is like strictly behind us 100%, no matter where we're at, what we're doing.
Secretary England thanks sailors and Marines for their dedication to our country.
This is a terrific force we have, the United States Navy and our United States Marines. The president said be ready. They are ready. It's been just terrific to visit with these fine men and women on board ship.
Petty Officer Dwayne Smith, Navy Marine Corps News.
The SECNAV was on board the Bella Wood within 48 hours of their departure for a scheduled six-month deployment.
Good leadership can guide a crew responding during times of crisis or help a crew set the example for the fleet. Both situations were the case in deciding the recipients of the 2001 Vice Admiral James Stockdale Leadership Awards. Sergeant Jimmy Perkins has more.
The recipients of the annual Vice Admiral James Stockdale Leadership Award were announced recently in an awards ceremony at the Pentagon. Commander Jeffrey Jones and Commander John Richardson received the award based on nominations from their peers and from the Atlantic and Pacific Fleet commanders. The Stockdale Award recognizes outstanding leadership shown by the commanding officer of a ship, submarine, or aviation squadron. The award is named after former prisoner of war and Medal of Honor recipient, Vice Admiral James Stockdale.
There's a haunting continuum of interest in people who are military commanders who have polished themselves into having a lot of finesse and drive. And that's what we were looking for here.
Commander Jones's nomination cited his leadership aboard USS Hawes during its efforts to help the crew of USS Cole save their ship following its attack October 12, 2000.
The Hawes certainly was one of the best frigates on the in the fleet right now, back-to-back Battle E winner, and has a real strong reputation and a lot of hard-working folks on there that put out a lot of dedication and effort in doing the country's mission.
Commander Richardson was nominated for his leadership aboard the USS Honolulu. Besides receiving the Battle E for 2000, USS Honolulu built a reputation for high morale, retention, and efficiency.
The good stuff we always try and highlight just as much so that everybody sees how it should be done right. And when you keep coming back to recognizing people's sacrifices and the great things they're doing, I think that makes everybody feel good about themselves, and they sure do.
Reporting from the Pentagon, Sergeant Jimmy Perkins, Navy Marine Corps News.
At a press conference October 24th, the Defense Department announced the award of an $18.9 billion contract to the Lockheed Martin Company to continue development on the Joint Strike Fighter aircraft. It's the largest contract of its kind.
The Joint Strike Fighter is a family of aircraft with different capabilities to meet each service's needs.
There are three variants, one for conventional takeoff and landing applied to the Air Force mission, a carrier deck compatible variant for the Navy, and a short takeoff and vertical landing STOVL variant for the Marine Corps and the United Kingdom. The Joint Strike Fighter will be the world's premier strike platform beginning in 2008 and lasting through 2040. It will provide an air-to-air capability second only to the F-22 air superiority fighter. The Joint Strike Fighter will allow for migration by U.S. forces to an almost all-stealth fighter force by 2025.
The Joint Strike Fighter is designed to replace the Navy's early model F-18s and the Marine Corps' AV-8Bs. You can expect to see the fighters in the fleet in 2008.
Family members recently crowded the piers in Norfolk, Virginia to welcome home their sailors.
Sailors of the USS Enterprise Battle Group received a warm welcome of patriotic music, signs, and hugs and kisses. The tempo of the battle group changed following the September 11th terrorist attacks because four deployed ships went to a heightened state of alert.
We stepped up security a whole lot, you know, and of course port visits got canceled, and training, a lot of training.
Ships returning with the Enterprise battle group included USS Deo, Thorne, and Gonzales, and also the USS Kearsarge Amphibious Ready Group.
Family members also welcome Marines of the 24th Marine Expeditionary Unit, Special Operations Capable, when USS Kearsarge, Ponce, and Carter Hall dropped them off the coast of Camp Lejeune, North Carolina.
Last week, we told you about possible mail delays due to recent anthrax scares.
As the holiday season quickly approaches, it's recommended that you get any holiday mail out as soon as possible.
The current suggested mailing dates are November 6th for standard mail, November 27th for space available mail, December 4th for parcel airlift mail, December 11th for first class letters and cards and priority mail, and December 20th for express mail where service is authorized.
It's time for our first break. When we come back, find out what sailors and Marines were doing recently off the coast of Southern California.
Hello, shipmates. MCPON Herdt here. More than two centuries of American heroes will be recognized in hundreds of Veterans Day ceremonies across America next week. They come from every background and heritage present in America. They all had the same motivation, an unwavering love for their country and a commitment to freedom. More recently, our shipmates at the Pentagon and those involved in the relief efforts in New York City fought so heroically to save their shipmates and fellow Americans for that same belief in freedom. They served with every ounce of honor, courage, and commitment that anyone could possibly expect. It's now up to us to carry on fighting for the cause of freedom. The world relies on us to pay the bill for a way of life that every human being deserves. We have been, we are, and we will continue to be the best team in the world. God bless you, and I'll see you about the fleet.
Navy, accelerate your life.
Man, I had the best job. Great friends, awesome career. How could I have been so stupid? I'd still be in the Navy if I hadn't smoked pot. I really screwed up.
Choose the road to opportunity and success. Or get high and go nowhere. It's your choice.
Welcome back to Navy Marine Corps News.
The Bon Homme Richard Amphibious Ready Group got together recently with the 13th Marine Expeditionary Unit for a two-week training exercise off the Southern California coast. Petty Officer Charles Finks of our San Diego Bureau has more.
The September 11th attacks on America have affected our country to its very core, and the military is no exception. But sailors and Marines haven't lost a bit of hope. They're still training hard and feeling confident that they're ready for action.
Because no matter what, we'll come through. We'll do what we have to do. And no matter what the situation, we'll take care of it. I mean, that's the way I look at it. Because you can't always plan for, you can't plan for every scenario, so you got to be prepared for everything. So that's the way it's going to be.
Marines and sailors are preparing for everything, including the possibility of a quick deployment.
It's like a reality check now, you know? Because back in the day, I mean, I had a couple t-shirts, and I was like, I'm not going out to sea any minute. And then this happened, and it's like, now it's a reality check, and I always have to be ready. You never know when duty does call.
Whenever duty calls, these Marines and sailors will be ready.
What we want is to make a difference. You know, we want the Bon Homme Richard to do our part.
From USS Bon Homme Richard, I'm Petty Officer Charles Finks, Navy Marine Corps News.
Sailors aboard deployed ships rely on support from other commands. Petty Officer Mary Wilson of our Sigonella Bureau tells us how one squadron supplies ships at sea with the things they need to stay underway.
There are many jobs in the Navy that have direct impact on mission and sailors' morale. One of these jobs is fleet logistics support, and the sailors assigned to Helicopter Combat Support Squadron 4 know this.
When you come out there with 15,000 pounds of mail inside of a helicopter, they're pretty happy to see you.
The sailors of HC4 supply ships at sea with more than just mail.
Everything that needs to go to the boat, cargo, parts, people, food, fruits and vegetables, anything.
But in order to get supplies to ships at sea, HC4 must have aircraft ready at any time. That's why the ground crew is so important.
Without the maintainers here, these things don't fly.
Also part of the ground crew are the sailors who track the paperwork and logbooks for the aircraft. That ensures jobs are being done right.
We couldn't do certain missions if the aircraft doesn't have the allotted hours or times or the allotted type of support that we need with the basic parts that we have. We have to make sure that what we have is up to date and up to speed in order for the aircraft to be able to have safe flight.
The two kinds of crew members on board the helicopter are the pilots whose job is to fly the aircraft and the air crewmen.
The air crewmen act as load masters. We back the pilots up on any emergency procedures that come up in flight. And we're basically in charge of the cabin area after the pilot station.
Sailors at HC4 keep deployed ships stocked full of necessities. That's their job. But keeping their aircraft ready at a moment's notice is another job in and of itself.
Every time you see that aircraft fly, you know that you had something to do with it. You were part of the reason that aircraft is going.
HC4 will continue to support the fleet with whatever it might need, from cargo to mail to transporting troops. From Sigonella, Sicily, I'm Petty Officer Mary Wilson, Navy Marine Corps News.
The San Diego-based destroyer USS John Paul Jones is part of the naval forces launching attacks in support of Operation Enduring Freedom.
Petty Officer Kelly Hasley of our San Diego Bureau reports on how another destroyer prepares for its future deployment.
USS Decatur is a destroyer similar to USS John Paul Jones, one of the ships supporting Operation Enduring Freedom. The Decatur has guided missile systems and other weapons capabilities.
We can carry Tomahawk missiles, surface-to-air missiles against aircraft, or we can carry vertical launch rockets against submarines.
Sailors control the different weapon systems from the Combat Information Center, or the brain of the ship. One of the main parts of the brain is the optical sight. It's a camera used with the gun system.
It'll give us a visual on whatever we're trying to engage, so we can confirm its presence, how far we are off of firing, and it can also be used to search for potentially hostile surface targets.
The sailors aboard the Decatur aren't sure if they'll be called upon to support Operation Enduring Freedom. What they are sure of is, if the call comes, they'll be ready.
We train for this. This is what we do. We're a service, and part of our job is to deploy to where the president and our nation needs us.
These sailors feel confident in their ship's capabilities and in their training.
I know the crew is well trained, and we all are ready to do our job. We know what we have to do, and I feel confident in our combat readiness.
From USS Decatur at Naval Station San Diego, Petty Officer Kelly Hasley, Navy Marine Corps News.
A few weeks ago, we told you about Operation Dear Abby, a program that delivers mail to deployed U.S. forces.
But because of recent mail-related attacks, the Defense Department has suspended the program. Normal mail delivery to service members will continue.
It's time for another break. We'll be right back with a look at this year's Marine Corps Marathon.
It is more than a trial by fire. It is a rite of passage. And if you can master your fear, outsmart your enemy, and never yield, even to yourself, you will be changed forever. The few, the proud, the Marines.
What's up?
Was that Petty Officer Brown?
You mean ex-Petty Officer Brown. He got kicked out for popping positive on a urinalysis.
Man, what a waste. He just made first.
He did, didn't he?
I guess he just never figured it out.
Well, hey, we better get going. Class starts in 5 minutes.
Choose the road to opportunity and success, or get high and go nowhere. It's your choice.
Welcome back.
The Marine Corps helps kids achieve a healthy lifestyle through a variety of programs. So last year, officials began another program, a mini version of the Marine Corps Marathon.
Kids ages 7 to 12 from all over the nation participated in the second Marine Corps Marathon Kids Fun Run at the Marine Corps War Memorial in Arlington, Virginia. A new generation of runners got a feel of what participating in a marathon is all about. Many of the 450 kids were running for the first time, so the motivation they received from the Marines was very helpful.
I came out here the first time, not knowing what to expect. However, I went up there and just started just pumping them up, trying to. But however, the kids pumped me up. I fed off the kids. The kids are just so motivated.
Having a personal goal was one of the things that helped get some of these runners through the race.
I really wanted to beat my school mile time,
and I thought it would be really fun to run another mile.
The kids set their own pace, and it didn't even matter when they came across the finish line, because the Marines were there to treat them all like winners.
They all receive ribbons, and the Marines give a big hoorah for them.
Marathon race director Rick Nealis says he feels the kids' fun run can eventually be as big as the Marine Corps Marathon.
In 1976, a small group of Marines discovered that dreams really do come true. It was the end of the Vietnam era, the bicentennial year, and the birth of something new, the Marine Corps Marathon. Petty Officer April Ash has more.
The first Marine Corps Marathon started here at the Marine Corps Memorial with a little over 1,000 participants. Today, they celebrate the 26th marathon with over 18,000 runners. They have come from all over the nation and the world to celebrate this marathon, also known as the People's Marathon.
It unites people. Anybody who has the will to sign up for the marathon can get in.
Even a firefighter running in full gear. It was his way of honoring the fallen heroes in New York.
So far, so good.
Runners look for motivation and support to help carry them from start to finish.
Let's go, let's go!
That support came in the form of signs, applause, and even some good old-fashioned cheerleading.
Coming by the hill here with everybody lining the road for a mile there, you almost can't help running a lot faster than you even want to just because everybody's screaming.
You're almost there!
Just a few miles into the race, runners faced a grim reminder of where our country now stands.
I just couldn't take my eyes off it.
It makes your own struggles not seem that big of a deal.
I just stared at the building. I was in awe. I mean, I had goosebumps the size of golf balls.
Well, just seeing the Pentagon running through there, you can't help but feel a lot of emotions.
Runners found out at the finish line why the Marine Corps Marathon is so special.
They treat the number one runner and the number 20,000th runner the same.
The Marines gave all runners medals for finishing the race and extra special attention to make them all feel like winners. I'm Petty Officer April Ash, Navy Marine Corps News.
Kamal Ayari of New Rochelle, New York, took first place in the wheelchair division. The first place male winner was retired Gunnery Sergeant Farley Simon from Honolulu. He's the only Marine to win the Marine Corps Marathon, and he's done it twice. And if you're wondering, his pace was 5 minutes, 37 seconds, so he was moving.
Hey, that's pretty impressive. The first place female winner was Lori Stitch Zimmerman from Beaverton, Oregon. And the British Royal Navy took first place in the Armed Forces team category.
Making a port visit in Hawaii can be rewarding, but it requires a lot of time to see the sights.
Seaman John Watts from our Pearl Harbor Bureau tells us how some French sailors made the best of their time in Hawaii with the help of some local Hawaiian residents.
Recently, the French naval ship Prairial pulled into Honolulu Harbor, and members of the local community offered their time, providing the sailors with a unique liberty opportunity.
The people you're going to entertain are no more or no less apprehensive than you are, perhaps. They don't know the situation they're coming into, and you don't either.
But that didn't stop retired Navy Captain Randy Jaycox from showing the two French sailors the sights they might have missed on their own. Through the International Hospitality Center, he regularly volunteers to escort foreign sailors. While the sailors enjoy the sights, Captain Jaycox says he's interested in the dialogue.
It's a good thing for us to do for us. It helps broaden your horizons. You meet people from other countries. You talk to them.
For the sailors, the benefits are obvious.
C'est voyant et de voir un petit peu l'île en détail en ayant un guide assez intéressant.
Yeah, it's a way to communicate with the local people and to have another view of Hawaii.
And no view of Hawaii is complete without a cookout on the beach.
We hope they liked it. We hope they enjoyed what they saw. I think they did. But, you know, we've been sitting down here having a nice barbecue, a nice picnic lunch at the beach. I think they've all enjoyed themselves very much. We've certainly enjoyed ourselves. What else do you want?
Yeah.
Well, for them, it's a way to change their mind and to see, to relax and to see other things, to go out and, yeah, to visit the country or the place where they are.
And this time around, Captain Jaycox was especially happy to entertain his guests.
I told them how much we Americans appreciated the support that we're getting from their countries.
Reporting from Honolulu, I'm Seaman John Watts, Navy Marine Corps News.
The employees of the Office of Personnel Management inside the Theodore Roosevelt Federal Building in Washington, D.C. want to help their country.
Doing their part turned out to be adopting the 5,500-member crew of their namesake aircraft carrier.
During the adoption ceremony, the auditorium inside the Theodore Roosevelt Building was packed with employees expressing their patriotic spirit and showing support for the TR and the U.S. Navy.
Almost within minutes of the ship leaving Norfolk and several employees having seen that on television and seen the Theodore Roosevelt as it left with, saying, we need to do something. We are here housed in the Theodore Roosevelt Building, and we want to do our part.
The adoption ceremony was highly anticipated by the event coordinators, especially the ship's sponsor.
We want to expand our TR family. We want help to show our sailors how the American people feel about them. And we are excited to unite with the families of the Office of Personnel Management, a sibling in the legacy of President Roosevelt.
Employees in the Roosevelt Building plan to support the sailors by sending letters, care packages, and music CDs through their family members.
We're going to be there for the long haul for you and for the crew of the USS Theodore Roosevelt. Is that right, family? Yeah.
As a symbol of the adoption, a 12-foot spirit banner signed by the employees will be sent to the ship.
Well, that's the show for this week. As always, we'd like to hear your thoughts and ideas about Navy Marine Corps news. So call our feedback line or send us an email.
The number and address are coming up in a minute. But before we go, we'd like to say BZ to Naval Mobile Construction Battalions 1 and 21 for receiving the fiscal year 2001 Atlantic Fleet NMCB Battle E.
NMCB 1, the active duty recipient, is homeported in Gulfport, Mississippi.
And NMCB 21, the reserve recipient, is based in Lakehurst, New Jersey.
We'd also like to say hello and thanks for watching to our viewers in Olympia, Washington, who watch our show every week on Thurston Community TV.
We leave you this week with another look at the participants who ran and cheered at this year's Marine Corps Marathon.
Until next week.
Take care.
The recipients of the annual Vice Admiral James Stockdale Leadership Award were announced recently in an awards ceremony at the Pentagon. Commander Jeffrey Jones and Commander John Richardson received the award based on nominations from their peers and from the Atlantic and Pacific Fleet commanders. The Stockdale Award recognizes outstanding leadership shown by the commanding officer of a ship, submarine, or aviation squadron. The award is named after former prisoner of war and Medal of Honor recipient, Vice Admiral James Stockdale.
There's a haunting continuum of interest in people who are military commanders who have polished themselves into having a lot of finesse and drive. And that's what we were looking for here.
Commander Jones's nomination cited his leadership aboard USS Hawes during its efforts to help the crew of USS Cole save their ship following its attack October 12, 2000.
The Hawes certainly was one of the best frigates on the, you know, in the fleet right now. Back-to-back Battle E winner, and has a real strong reputation, and a lot of hard-working folks on there that put out a lot of dedication and effort in doing the country's mission.
Commander Richardson was nominated for his leadership aboard the USS Honolulu. Besides receiving the Battle E for 2000, USS Honolulu built a reputation for high morale, retention, and efficiency.
The good stuff we always try and highlight just as much so that everybody sees how it should be done right. And when you keep coming back to recognizing people's sacrifices and the great things they're doing, I think that makes everybody feel good about themselves, and they sure do.
Reporting from the Pentagon, Sergeant Jimmy Perkins, Navy Marine Corps News.
Does the term human error mean?
Defense officials say they're moving at their own pace in the war against terrorism.
We do not intend to stop until we've rooted out terrorist networks and put them out of business, not just in the case of the Taliban and the Al-Qaeda in Afghanistan, but other networks as well.
Defense Secretary Donald Rumsfeld says the campaign will continue until Americans can go about their lives without fear.
Americans, as you know, do not seek war. We did not seek this war. It was thrust upon us. It is a matter of self-defense, and the only way to defend against terrorist acts is to take the battle to the terrorists. It was thrust upon us, and we love liberty, and we need to do whatever it will take to defend it.
Military leaders reiterated that this fight is a marathon and not a sprint.
The Taliban and Al-Qaeda are unlikely to take a holiday. And given the fact that they have killed thousands of Americans and people from 50 or 60 other countries, and given the fact that they have sworn to continue such attacks, we have an obligation to defend the American people, and we intend to work diligently to do that.
There are three variants, one for conventional takeoff and landing applied to the Air Force mission, a carrier deck compatible variant for the Navy, and a short takeoff and vertical landing STOVL variant for the Marine Corps and the United Kingdom. The Joint Strike Fighter will be the world's premier strike platform beginning in 2008 and lasting through 2040. It will provide an air-to-air capability second only to the F-22, air superiority fighter. The Joint Strike Fighter will allow for migration by U.S. forces to an almost all-stealth fighter force by 2025.
Sailors of the USS Enterprise Battle Group received a warm welcome of patriotic music, signs, and hugs and kisses. The tempo of the battle group changed following the September 11th terrorist attacks because four deployed ships went to a heightened state of alert.
Yeah, we stepped up security a whole lot, you know, and of course port visits got canceled, and training, a lot of training.
Ships returning with the Enterprise Battle Group included USS Deo, Thorn, and Gonzales, and also the USS Kearsarge Amphibious Ready Group. There are many jobs in the Navy that have direct impact on mission and sailors' morale. One of these jobs is fleet logistics support, and the sailors assigned to Helicopter Combat Support Squadron 4 know this.
When you come out there with 15,000 pounds of mail inside of a helicopter, they're pretty happy to see you.
The sailors of HC4 supply ships at sea with more than just mail.
Everything that needs to go to the boat, cargo, parts, people, food, fruits and vegetables, anything.
But in order to get supplies to ships at sea, HC4 must have aircraft ready at any time. That's why the ground crew is so important.
Without the maintainers here, these things don't fly.
Also part of the ground crew are the sailors who track the paperwork and logbooks for the aircraft. That ensures jobs are being done right.
We couldn't do certain missions if the aircraft doesn't have the allotted hours or times or the allotted type of support that we need with the basic parts that we have. We have to make sure that what we have is up to date and up to speed in order for the aircraft to be able to have safe flight.
The two kinds of crew members on board the helicopter are the pilots whose job is to fly the aircraft and the air crewmen.
The air crewmen act as load masters. We back the pilots up on any emergency procedures that come up in flight. And we're basically in charge of the cabin area after the pilot station.
Sailors at HC4 keep deployed ships stocked full of necessities. That's their job. But keeping their aircraft ready at a moment's notice is another job in and of itself.
Every time you see that aircraft fly, you know that you had something to do with it. You were part of the reason that aircraft is going.
HC4 will continue to support the fleet with whatever it might need, from cargo to mail to transporting troops. From Sigonella, Sicily, I'm Petty Officer Mary Wilson, Navy Marine Corps News.
The September 11th attacks on America have affected our country to its very core, and the military is no exception. But sailors and Marines haven't lost a bit of hope. They're still training hard and feeling confident that they're ready for action.
Because no matter what, we'll come through. We'll do what we have to do. And no matter what the situation, we'll take care of it. I mean, that's the way I look at it. Because you can't always plan for, you can't plan for every scenario, so you got to be prepared for everything. So that's the way it's going to be.
Marines and sailors are preparing for everything, including the possibility of a quick deployment.
It's like a reality check now, you know? Because back in the day, I mean, I had a couple t-shirts, and I was like, I'm not going out to sea any minute. And then this happened, and it's like, now it's a reality check, and I always have to be ready. You never know when duty does call.
Whenever duty calls, these Marines and sailors will be ready.
What we want is to make a difference. You know, we want the Bon Homme Richard to do our part.
From USS Bon Homme Richard, I'm Petty Officer Charles Finks, Navy Marine Corps News.
USS Decatur is a destroyer similar to USS John Paul Jones, one of the ships supporting Operation Enduring Freedom. The Decatur has guided missile systems and other weapons capabilities.
We can carry Tomahawk missiles, surface-to-air missiles against aircraft, or we can carry vertical launch rockets against submarines.
Sailors control the different weapon systems from the Combat Information Center, or the brain, of the ship. One of the main parts of the brain is the optical sight. It's a camera used with the gun system.
It'll give us a visual on whatever we're trying to engage, so we can confirm its presence, how far we are off of firing. And it can also be used to search for potentially hostile surface targets.
The sailors aboard the Decatur aren't sure if they'll be called upon to support Operation Enduring Freedom. What they are sure of is, if the call comes, they'll be ready.
We train for this. This is what we do. We're a service, and part of our job is to deploy to where the president and our nation needs us.
These sailors feel confident in their ship's capabilities and in their training.
I know the crew is well trained, and we all are ready to do our job. We know what we have to do, and I feel confident in our combat readiness.
From USS Decatur at Naval Station San Diego, Petty Officer Kelly Hasley, Navy Marine Corps News.
Recently, the French naval ship Prairial pulled into Honolulu Harbor, and members of the local community offered their time, providing the sailors with a unique liberty opportunity.
The people you're going to entertain are no more or no less apprehensive than you are, perhaps. They don't know the situation they're coming into, and you don't either.
But that didn't stop retired Navy Captain Randy Jaycox from showing the two French sailors the sights they might have missed on their own. Through the International Hospitality Center, he regularly volunteers to escort foreign sailors. While the sailors enjoy the sights, Captain Jaycox says he's interested in the dialogue.
It's a good thing for us to do for us. It helps broaden your horizons. You meet people from other countries. You talk to them.
For the sailors, the benefits are obvious.
C'est voyant et de voir un petit peu l'île en détail en ayant guide, c'est intéressant.
Yeah, it's a way to communicate with the local people and to have another view of Hawaii.
And no view of Hawaii is complete without a cookout on the beach.
We hope they liked it. We hope they enjoyed what they saw. I think they did. But, you know, we've been sitting down here having a nice barbecue, a nice picnic lunch at the beach. I think they've all enjoyed themselves very much. We've certainly enjoyed ourselves. What else do you want?
Yeah.
Oh, for them, it's a way to change their mind and to see, to relax and to see other things, to go out and, to visit the country or the place where they are.
And this time around, Captain Jaycox was especially happy to entertain his guests.
I told them how much we Americans appreciated the support that we're getting from their countries.
Reporting from Honolulu, I'm Seaman John Watts, Navy Marine Corps News.
Sailors aboard the USS Bella Wood and USS John Young greeted Secretary Gordon England with rousing cheers.
It's an honor for all the ships out here that he chose our ship, and for a time like this that he took the time out to come out to speak to a crew, especially when we're getting ready for deployment.
It shows that not only him, the president, but the whole country, rest of the government and everybody else is like strictly behind us 100%, no matter where we're at, what we're doing.
Secretary England thanked sailors and Marines for their dedication to our country.
This is a terrific force we have, the United States Navy and our United States Marines. The President said be ready. They are ready. It's been just terrific to visit with these fine men and women on board ship.
Petty Officer Dwayne Smith, Navy Marine Corps News.
During the adoption ceremony, the auditorium inside the Theodore Roosevelt building was packed with employees expressing their patriotic spirit and showing support for the TR and the U.S. Navy.
Almost within minutes of the ship leaving Norfolk and several employees having seen that on television and seen the Theodore Roosevelt as it left with, saying, we need to do something. We are here housed in the Theodore Roosevelt building and we want to do our part.
The adoption ceremony was highly anticipated by the event coordinators, especially the ship's sponsor.
We want to expand our TR family. We want help to show our sailors how the American people feel about them. And we are excited to unite with the families of the Office of Personnel Management, a sibling in the legacy of President Roosevelt.
Employees in the Roosevelt building plan to support the sailors by sending letters, care packages, and music CDs through their family members.
We're going to be there for the long haul for you and for the crew of the USS Theodore Roosevelt. Is that right, family?
Yeah. As a symbol of the adoption, a 12-foot spirit banner signed by the employees will be sent to the ship.
The first Marine Corps Marathon started here at the Marine Corps Memorial with a little over 1,000 participants. Today they celebrate the 26th Marathon with over 18,000 runners. They have come from all over the nation and the world to celebrate this marathon, also known as the People's Marathon.
It unites people. Anybody who has the will to sign up for the marathon can get in.
Even a firefighter running in full gear. It was his way of honoring the fallen heroes in New York.
So far, so good.
Runners look for motivation and support to help carry them from start to finish.
Let's go, let's go!
That support came in the form of signs, applause, and even some good old-fashioned cheerleading.
Coming by the hill here with everybody lining the road for a mile there, you almost can't help running a lot faster than you even want to just because everybody's screaming.
You're almost there!
Just a few miles into the race, runners faced a grim reminder of where our country now stands.
I just couldn't take my eyes off it.
It makes your own struggles not seem that big of a deal.
I just stared at the building. I was in awe. I mean, I had goosebumps the size of golf balls.
Well, just seeing the Pentagon running through there, you can't help but feel a lot of emotions.
Runners found out at the finish line why the Marine Corps Marathon is so special.
They treat the number one runner and the number 20,000th runner the same.
The Marines gave all runners medals for finishing the race and extra special attention to make them all feel like winners. I'm Petty Officer April Ash, Navy Marine Corps News.
Rock to the bottom to the beat, don't stop. I'm coming to the what you got to give it, makes you hot. Rock to the bottom to the beat.